Welcome to the Life of a Global Desi,
a podcast that connects like-minded Desis all over the globe by conforming to stereotypes and breaking them.
Introducing Life of a Global Desi Interviews.
Yes, we bring to you our conversations with remarkable global Desis who are doing some really cool things in life.
The idea is to bring fresh perspectives, add diverse voices, and expand the global Desi community. On to our episode now. Hello, everyone. Today's guest is Arjun Menon, who's an editorial, travel and commercial automotive photographer, a very high-functioning creative, and the founder of Art Leaves a Mark. His body of work include The Extraordinary, The Indian Army, and India Changed the Perception, among many other phenomenal pieces of art. His personal projects have been featured on BuzzFeed, NDTV, Condé Nast Traveler, and Vogue India. He's a TEDx speaker and is also an alumni of Sir Robert Swan's International Expedition to Antarctica. Arjun is also a contributing photographer to Condé Nast Traveler India. Currently, he's based out of Mumbai. He has executed multiple projects around the world, ranging from Canada, New Zealand, Colombia, Peru, Bolivia, Argentina, and Antarctica. A true global Desi in that sense. Can't wait for our conversation. Stay tuned.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to yet another episode of Life of a Global Desi.
Yay!
We have a really special guest on our show today, and we have Arjun Menon.
Woohoo!
Arjun, do you want to say hi?
Hi, guys. How's it going?
Yay. Okay. So, Arjun is my childhood best friend, and we have grown up together at a lot of different places where our dads have been posted together. They both were in the Indian Army. And just remote places, right? Like Dharangdhara, Gujarat, Patiala, Punjab. And some of my fondest memories have been of us chasing rabbits together, biking endlessly, playing cricket indoors.
Swimming.
And yes, swimming.
We learned swimming together.
Yes, we did learn swimming together.
Tree houses. We had so many tree houses.
Tree houses, yo, seriously. And then collecting Tazos, a very 90s reference yeah. for those of you, you know, Gen Zs tuning in. And most recently, I had the honor of giving a toast at his wedding.
Man, we've all grown up so much.
Weddings come such a long adulthood happening.
For sure.
Very much so. And he is hilarious as a person, super goofy to be around, sometimes mean funny, but he's only mean to those people who he absolutely loves. Aww. It's a very distinguished title you will get if he's being mean and funny with you at the same time. And he loves people and stories and has this knack of connecting with people just at the core level. And it's just beautiful to watch him do that. And he's a silent feminist as well. No matter
closeted
how much he makes
feminist.
Fun of this,
yeah.
He is. He's a silent feminist. He'll joke around and say mean things, but he is a feminist at the core. And he's all heart and fluff to the bottom. Like, he's just all goodness and mushy to the core. So that's how I describe Arjun. And I am just so proud and honored to have him on the show.
Oh, yeah. Arti, you can see that Arti is tearing up. And to her point, we are all like childhood best friends, like super close. We've been through so much together in terms of, you know, just having too much fun and also getting caught and, you know, like our parents busting our asses, all of that. But it's been super fun. So great. So Arti and I obviously know Arjun really well, but for our listeners, so they get to know you better, Arjun, we want to do a quick icebreaker. Okay.
Sure.
So if you could have unlimited supply of one thing for the rest of your life, what would it be and why?
Oh man, that's a tough one. I'm looking at Milka chocolate.
the purple wrapper one.
The purple wrapper one with hazelnut, and that's the specificity. That's the only thing I buy for myself when I'm traveling. So let it be like a 3-month trip. Yeah, exactly. So all that I get for myself is that those three bars that I get, like those big ones, and I like hog them over the next 2-3 weeks. But I feel that is a good starter for me to like have a survival kit ready for me, like especially in the days of doom.
Yep. Yeah. Perfect. Milka is right the one. Now.
Yeah, that's not even the best chocolate, but okay, I hear you. Even people have preferences, right?
No. Stop being so judgmental.
Listen, if you want to say something
I take that back. Yeah. Negative about it. Okay, so yeah,
Milka is the good. Best.
Let's honor our guest.
Yeah, no, it is good. I agree. It's pretty decent. But yeah, I mean, but that makes sense if you want to pick it up. Cool. So,
what's your favorite chocolate? Wait, let me just.
Like some of these really high end, like I mean not really high end.
Oh my god, so bougie then.
Yeah, let me not go there. Jumping right into getting to know you better, Arjun.
Yes.
What are some identities that you strongly associate with, right? And what were some early influences growing up?
Right. So as you mentioned, our parents were our dads were in the army and they had like a army childhood happening. Mm-hmm. So whether you like it or not, that was a big part of us growing up. So I naturally and I genuinely used to feel my dad had the coolest job because he was a pilot in the Indian Army, and for a regular basis he would be doing missions where he would rescue people, or you know, deliver goods, or you know, travel to these remote places. He used to describe some of these places as like no other human might have seen some of these places because they're so inside the Himalayas and 20,000 feet up, and there's no access to anybody else. So I feel like that's my dad, like to start off with. A huge influence. And then growing up, lots of sports happened. So I got into basketball. So Vince Carter, who actually retired yesterday.
Oh, okay.
Because the NBA season got suspended, and this was his last game, last season. And so he actually retired yesterday. And I actually made a bucket list when I was like 18 of things that I want to do things that I want to do before I'm 25, right? And I had made a list where it felt far-fetched at the time, but I wanted to meet Vince Carter, and I made this list, and you know, I had these tick marks everywhere. And funny thing is that I actually went all the way to US to watch his game, and I got to meet him, which is quite crazy because a small kid growing up in New Bombay, for him to actually do that is mad. Like some of these things that I have done, I never thought I could ever kind of do. So meeting Vince Carter was one of them. It was just like, and he was such an amazing human being. He entertained me. He signed my board, like my jersey, and. In the middle of an NBA match, I was in the halftime game. Mm-hmm. I mean, things like these. Yeah. I mean, just I've been following NBA since like I don't even know, like 20 years now, and then suddenly I'm in the middle of a halftime show and stuff. It was just mad. So
yeah, man, dreams like come true, and life is just so bizarre sometimes. Like you know, exactly. Reality is so much more strange, like stranger than fiction. It's crazy.
Exactly,
you can't plan this stuff.
True, very true.
Awesome. Cool. I think that makes a lot of sense, you know, in terms of just the childhood and growing up, and seems like just seeing new places, travel, all of that has been super influential. Awesome. Yeah.
So why we have you on this podcast is because you are one of the top photographers in India. And that's how I would describe you as. And whoa, like just knowing you is like
wow. For those of you who can't see, Arjun's like, you know, tapping his shoulder saying good job.
That's Arjun for you.
That's just okay, you're just being too kind, but okay, thanks.
No,
I'll take it.
I mean, come on, don't be humble right now at least. So one of the top photographers in India. So can you trace back like where this came from. Do you remember the first time you picked up a camera or took a picture? Like, and what's the first frame that you clicked?
It's a very complicated story. If you want me to get into it, it's quite a long
Do
one.
It.
Okay. So, I find myself... Okay, a lot of shit happened, okay? It starts from when I was 13. One day, suddenly, it's a Sunday. We are chilling at home. My dad's on flying. Me and my mom were just about to get out and go for shopping. And I was actually telling her, like, let's go for shopping in the evening. And she was like, you know, God knows what will happen by evening. Let's just go now. So we were on our way. We were just getting out of the house when we got a call from our uncle saying, just check out the news. There's some news happening. And my dad is a pilot, right? So we rushed to the bedroom. We check out the news and apparently there's a helicopter crash. Now, no other details, you know, where it is. And we didn't even exactly know where my dad was flying. He was flying somewhere in Karnataka. Nothing, no mentions. And then we were trying to figure out, you know, what's happening. Because we were all like very anxious, me and my mom. And that's when the bell rang. I was still sitting in my my bedroom and I could see the corridor. My mom rushed. She opened the door and it happened to be my dad's colleague. And for some reason, I'm sitting in my room and I was like, that's weird. Like, why is he here? Because we don't usually have my dad's colleague at home, right? And then he says something to mom. Mom just bursts out crying. And me sitting in my room, I was like, shit, I think the worst thing has happened. I think we've lost my dad. And so from that day itself, like things like totally changed. A precursor to that is like me and my dad always had these cold wars happening. Because I used to do bad in school. I used to fake signatures because that was like a thing I used to do then. And one of these days they found out and the principal called them to school. And he in fact like slapped me in front of my mom. So my mom was in shock and then my dad was like, I'm not talking to you. So for the previous 2 months before this incident happened, I wasn't talking to my dad. So it was like zero contact and then suddenly this happened and I just fell into this well of, you know, I couldn't even get out of that phase of depression. I didn't even know what it's called. I didn't even know there's a term for it called depression. But this is where I found myself. For months and months and months, I would just, wake up crying in the middle of the night, not even knowing why. But I never had any kind of closure because of the things that preceded the event. My mom, for the first time, she's been a housewife all her life. At the age of 38, I saw her picking up books and going to NIT classes and having teenagers as classmates and having that entire vigor and the determination to somehow make it work in this world, because we are now living in Bombay. It's one of the most expensive cities in the world. And we somehow had to survive, right? So my mom totally transformed herself into this superhuman. She set the way. She started working for me and my brother. My brother also actually, he's just 17 when it happened, so barely passed his. He didn't appear for his 12th. Actually, he was in 11th grade, and suddenly he was, expected to be an adult, which is quite difficult. And he took up that role, because when that moment happens, it comes from wherever it is. I somehow had. I was very well protected, and from my mom and brother, they all treated me like a kid. So that kind of pressure didn't come to me. And then eventually I got myself into microbiology and life sciences. I thought it was about animals, but no, you don't see any animals in the, it's only microscopes, and you end up like having your entire day spent in the lab. On the other side, I'm used to my childhood is all about travel, because my dad was a very passionate traveler, and like, he used to take us out every 2 weeks to some of the other beautiful places. And so this was the longest phase we've been in one place, and so I was kind of frustrated, and that's when my brother bought a small DSLR, point and shoot camera. I started experimenting with it. I used to go to Kerala, I click a lot of insect photos, and I used to have fun with it. Like, I used to be in my backyard just for like hours and hours and hours, clicking insect photographs. And I fell in love with these insects. It was just mad. And then, as in when I, like, the time came to make a decision, I just wanted to make sure that I complete my degree in life sciences, because I had already started it. And my mom was like, she has seen people fail at things that they don't enjoy, right? People have careers and suddenly they're fired, and the careers that they'd never enjoyed. So she was like, might as well give it a shot at a career that, makes sense to you and you enjoy doing, so that it never feels like labor. And I suddenly thought, and that's about the time when I saw, it's very cliche, but Into the Wild. I teared up one night, like properly crying, and my mom, I used to wake up late in the night. My mom woke up, she was doing her prayers, and I hugged her, and I was like, I want to be a travel photographer. And my mom was like, go for it. Like, a thumbs up from her end. And I was like, that's all that I wanted to hear. And I knew that I needed to make it by myself, because had no history in this field and whatever. So I got into a lot of internships, assisted a ton of photographers. So probably the first 3 years I was assisting photographers. I was lucky to assist some amazing photographers all over the world, whenever they would come down to India. Mm-hmm. And that's how the photography journey started. It was, some of it was a catalyst through me wanting to get out of the laboratory. Some of it was the thrill of creating, having my own space and enjoying that. Like, that really spoke to me. I could see myself doing this for the rest of my life, so I thought. But and so that's a very gradual decision that happened, and there were a lot of factors that played their role. And then so there's not like that one frame that I can point out to, but like a bunch of things that happened, and it's almost like a rolling snowball, like that decision ultimately, it felt like the most natural decision to make at the time.
Thanks for sharing that, Arjun. I remember very very vividly the incident, absolutely, because Menon uncle had come to our house literally the day before he was flying, I think, or maybe 2 days before he was flying, met my parents. I was right there. And of course, it was, like you rightly said, during the time of the exams, right? I was giving my 10th boards. Siddharth Bhai was giving his exams. And it was such a lovely evening and really reminisced about all the beautiful times we've had together as the two families and, you know, traveling and going on picnics, all of that, right? It was a beautiful time, for sure. And it's incredible how you've taken an experience like that, you know, which obviously changes you completely overnight, and channelized all of those emotions and energies into creating such beautiful art in this world, right? And I think it definitely speaks a lot when we look at those pictures. Every single picture that you put out, there's so much of heart there, and I definitely want to acknowledge that. And I think even to Ajita Aunty's credit, it's so brave during a time, but this is back, I'm talking about 10 years, 15 years, when professions like photography and the creative professions weren't really considered real careers or professions, right? The fact that she recognized it in you, your talent and your drive more than anything else, and really encouraged you to go for it and follow your passions and make it a full-time career. And how, Arjun, like, now you're one of the top photographers, you know, for photographing celebrities. Your work is in such illustrious magazines and you know, print and all over the web. So I definitely want to acknowledge that journey.
Thank you so much.
Great. And so I guess the other question I had, Arjun, was when you decided that, yes, this is my calling, taking photographs, telling stories through photography and creating art through photography, did you then formally study to be a photographer? Was there some formal study necessary? You said you did internships, but did you study to be a photographer?
Right, so my initial idea was to study. So as it turned out, in India, there weren't too many courses at the time. This was around, 12 years ago. The only courses that existed were perhaps in the US and UK. And those were really, really expensive. So for that time, it really did not make sense I really pursued it. I almost applied to a lot of universities.
Mm-hmm.
But the kind of numbers that... and we were not doing that well back at the time. So the kind of numbers, especially education, is very expensive.
Yeah, financially, right? It is a very expensive prospect, yeah.
So back then, it wasn't making sense. So I kind of logically thought about it, and I was like, what is the other way I can channelize my drive to learn? And that is how I did a couple of diploma courses in India, which was kind of a waste of time. But I got to intern under the creative director of MTV at the time.
Yeah.
And then I shifted to this travel magazine called Condé Nast Traveler. It's one of the biggest publications at the time. And so what I did was I started assisting photographers who would come down to India for shoots, because you had these amazing budgets of, they used to like call down photographers for each story, right? Each story that goes onto a magazine. And that time I had the opportunity to meet some of these amazing photographers from across the globe, right? I used to assist them, and then they would call me for their own personal shoots. So we had like a good rapport. Like there's like 4 or 5 good photographers, like really good photographers who are like still the industry leaders currently. And they enjoyed time with me, so I enjoyed time with them, and then they would call me out for different shoots everywhere. And so yeah, that was fun. So 3 years basically, all I was doing was learning. So there were 4 to 5 photographers who I was assisting, and then I did a ton of internships. And that's probably, I would rate it more than any kind of education I could have hoped for, because that's actually on ground education. Like No college can teach you what actually happens on a shoot and how to manage things. Those are not even photography related, but just like being a producer, being a director, being doing 10 of these roles at a time. That's probably like my the best learning experience I could ever hope for. And then I slowly started making my own portfolio. So I did my degree, and then 3 years later, I started photographing for myself. Meanwhile, So interesting story was I actually photographed my mom's eye.
Oh yeah, I remember that picture.
As
a crater on moon or some on Mars or something.
I did a workaround, and I made a normal lens into a macro lens, and experimented because my only subject was my mom at the time, so
she beautiful.
So I clicked a photograph of her eye, and then I uploaded it all over the web, and it got selected for the National Geographic Daily Dozen.
Woohoo,
which means
amazing.
Yeah, for me, somebody who's like just finding their way around photography, that was like a big morale booster. And then it kept happening, so I kept getting my photos selected, and then is when I eventually got my confidence ki, you know, I can probably make a career out of it. And then, yeah, slowly, slowly, one thing led to the other, and I became a contributor to the same magazine that I used to intern under.
Hmm.
So I basically replaced the photographers that used to come from other countries, and now I kind of do a lot of those shoots myself.
Wow.
So yeah, it's fun.
That is so cool.
It's fun.
You know, so what really stood out to me in your entire, you know, what you just spoke about right now was this whole idea of apprenticeship, right? Are you familiar with the 70-20-10 rule? It's something that I've been like digging deep into, but it goes like, to master anything, 70% of it has to be on the job. You do 70% of learning that skill on the job.
Right.
20% of it is through feedback, and only 10% is through like books or any formal kinds of courses and learning the concepts of
right.
it, right?
I totally
so
agree.
I feel like it totally stuck out in your experience that you were, you know, apprenticing under some of the best, and I'm sure you were learning so much and also getting feedback on your work in the process. So it explains why you actually attained such high levels of mastery in this field. So that's kind words,
but very honestly, like all the learning that happened was the technical skill is probably like, as you said, 10% of it. And that's where people get stuck, that, you know, you need to get the technique right. And that's an ever evolving skill. Like, you probably don't need to be 100% to start off with. You just need to start, and that's ultimately that's what matters. Most of people get stuck in the idea that it has to be perfect when you start, and then they keep delaying this process of getting into that venture. But for me, I knew that I don't have any formal education. This is what it is, and half of my learnings came through YouTube tutorials. And, my brother just giving me random advices, because he like my dad was into photography, and he used to give me advice on, you know, shutter speed and stuff like that. But that's what I'm saying. That's just like 10% of it. Most of it, like you said, is exactly what happens on the job, how you deal with people, how you handle people. It's more of that, you know, like, ultimately, if you need to get a good performance out of someone, it all depends on your communication. It's not even upon your photography skills, or it's not even upon your techniques and stuff. I mean, those can be the cherry on top, but your core lies in how you make them feel comfortable, your subject. Let it be an animal, let it be a landscape, like all of those things, those are like thousands of factors go into everything. But I would say like the technicality of it is just about 10%. Totally agree.
That's awesome. And you do so many different kinds of photography, right? I've seen some of your work and it's a broad range from like products, travel, celebrities, weddings, you know, journalistic stuff. I've seen some of that work as well. Which one's your favorite kind of photography and why?
So initially when I started off, because photography is a wide range of genres put in together, right? It's like a... So there's like fashion, exactly like you said, fashion, automotives, you can products, travel, everything. Like there's 10,000 genres. But what I initially wanted to do was I wanted to experiment on what I really enjoy, regardless if it pays well or not. And then I kind of wanted to narrow it down to things that I want to do. So initially, I started off with everything. So like I was doing fashion, I was doing product, I was doing weddings, I was doing all kinds of stuff. And then like as you kind of progress, you start realizing that these are some of the frustrations I have here. This is something I really hate about this industry. And then you kind of like, you know, narrow down your niche. And so, yeah, I used to photograph celebrities, as you said.
Yeah, we've seen a picture of Alia Bhatt, and you've taken that.
Like, what only a full
full celebrity, Arjun.
Grooving with full celebs is awesome.
A-listers, that too, not
and then so
exactly.
And then so I started realizing that I hate that stuff, right? So,
oh my god!
I used to
tell
hate,
us more. Give us juice.
Yeah. I used to hate this whole. Interacting with celebrities, and I never used to enjoy it because I never had a clean connection with them, even though it turned out like the product, like the photographs or the product we were creating turned out well.
Mm-hmm.
But I started realizing that I don't want to be doing this very often. So I now have like kind of almost figured, I'm still evolving. There are millions of things I have not tested yet, but I've kind of come to the agreement that, you know, automotive photography and travel is now my base. So for the last year I've shot with a lot of automotive brands, like I've been an ambassador for BMW and Volkswagen, and I've shot for like Jaguar, Land Rover, Ducatis, and Harley Davidson, all of these like brands that
are based on all luxury brands, man.
I know.
No, I mean, it started off small. I was making a portfolio where I was paying an assistant to be with me, although there's no money that comes out of a shoot. So all I did was make a portfolio. And once you make that portfolio, you approach these brands. They see a potential in you, so they trust you with more work. And that's how it built. So initially, I was doing a lot of work that did not pay at all. But that's your investment, right? That's your skill that you're trying to learn and the time that you put into it. And then slowly, 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 like people notice. And actually, it happened quite fast for me. But like in the last 2.5 years, I've shifted majorly into automotive photography, and I've always been into travel photography from the get-go, because that was one of my initial initial ideas of getting out of that whole space of a laboratory. So I enjoy travel, and I've been lucky to shoot for a lot of tourism boards and luxury hotel chains and magazines. So, yeah, I mean, those are the kind of work that I'm trying to do.
And so you bring up travel, Arjun. Of course, you know, the theme of travel has been pretty constant in your life. But what is this love between photographers and travel? I mean, I do see that everyone's trying to storytell through traveling, and we've seen movies, of course, you know, Ye Jawani Hai Diwani comes to mind, where Ranbir Kapoor is like this crazy travel photographer. And so what do you think is happening there?
Well, through Social media, right? I mean, I'm a product of social media. What happens is that normal people having 9-to-5 jobs, you know, try to have this perception that they have, like, these travel photographers have, like, the coolest jobs. And so everyone gravitates towards it, and you have huge number of following on all of these social media platforms. And so it's, I mean, partly it's, you know, instant gratification and being socially accepted, which starts off the whole social media trend. But I feel once you get over that, you start creating for yourself is when you try and discover yourself. Like, so initially, even me, what I was doing was I was trying to imitate a lot of work that I have seen other photographers, successful photographers do, and I would try to master it. And then you come to a point where suddenly you look at your portfolio and you're like, ah, this is not me. So what do I do now? Because all of your work is based on some other photographer, right? Because I used to assist photographers. I know what would Tom Parker do in this situation, and I used to shoot that way. And my magazine was happy with me, and everyone's happy because, you know. But somewhere down the line, I started realizing, oh, this is not me, and I need to probably start pushing my style and aesthetics into my work. Otherwise, it'll end up like, you know, a work inspired from everywhere and no real soul behind it.
And even being able to find out what your story is, right? I mean, what your style is. I think that's so difficult. How do you do that?
Yeah, exactly. So you it's a lot of experimenting, and it's a lot of getting to terms that this is you. Now, if you like it or not, this is who I am. And you need to have that discussion with yourself. You need to introspect that, you know, 50 years down the line, like whenever your career is over, you don't want to feel like you didn't give yourself a chance. So I, like, this happened to me like 2-3 years ago, like 7-8 years into my career, I started realizing that, you know, maybe I should do things differently. And you know what? People started identifying me for my work, which was amazing. Because like people used, so my magazine used to call me Tom Parker of India, right? Because Tom Parker is like this fancy photographer, and they used to call me Tom Parker of India because I had a similar style with him, and because I used to assist him. And then now they are more in terms of the photographer I am, so they trust me for what I can bring to a shoot and what I bring to, and that's a lot of learning, and that's a lot of introspection, that, you know, have that discussion with you that you find it cool or not, this is what you are, and you need to probably dive into that and explore that, and that leads you to different avenues. I feel like you keep, it's a journey that you keep exploring, right? Like, so now I don't even restrict myself to photography. I've done a few travel films. I don't try to restrict myself to one thing. So right now I came back from New Zealand. I was actually directing a documentary there. So because, like, you're in the modern era and you don't need to necessarily call yourself a photographer or a videographer or a director, you can be multiple things at a time, and you can excel. Like, the problem with me is that I get bored very easily. And that's what others have told me, is that when you try to master one thing and you kind of figure it out, it becomes boring to you. It becomes like, you know, what else can you even do here? And I can probably create whatever I want. But when you have this, when you open yourself to different avenues, you're still like a baby. You're trying to learn new things, right? And that's when you're more receptive to learning. And that's what I've been doing. That's what I've been trying to do. I've I broke my leg a few months ago, 3-4 months I was at home. What I was doing was I tried to learn. I had a tutor coming home and I tried to learn 3D, right? Like animation and graphics. Because you feel like a kid again. You feel like, oh my God, I know nothing about this, yeah. But wow, this is a world with infinite, outcome, and I would love to explore that. And so that keeps happening. And I feel like when you're in a creative field, if you're restricting yourself to any particular thing, you are kind of restricting your entire process of creation. So then I ventured into my first directorial film that we are doing now. And so it's exciting because we are constantly learning, and it's all new to me. And so it's hyper exciting. So yeah, that's
awesome. You know, two things there when you were speaking. For the first, you mentioned is you get bored very easily. I think that's such a common army brat trait. I feel like Aarti, yeah, and I feel the exact same way. We're a jack of all trades, and of course, you know, there's more breadth and depth in certain areas that really draw to us. So that's awesome. And the second thing you said about learning, Arjun, which was so fascinating, because we are in the age where you can't just rely on one skill anymore, right? I mean, gone are the days where you were the best accountant and you'd keep doing that, and or whatever profession you take, right? Because things are evolving so quickly and technology is making so many skills obsolete, right? Because obviously when we think about AI and all of that, what seems more long form, more eternal, is obviously creative arts. And within that also, what you can keep learning. And this is the age of learning. Like you said, YouTube, you know, you can actually pick up anything, anytime, from scratch.
Like,
yeah.
I'd say curiosity is the best currency in today's day and age.
True, exactly. And so the trait that you get bored easily is a very good aspect that way, because it keeps you curious towards other things. And look at what you guys are doing. I mean,
yeah, it's all through YouTube, figuring out how to make a podcast. What is a podcast? You know, like, how do you get the mic and all of it?
Exactly. So, for the first time probably in human history, information is not restricted to a few, right?
Yep.
So, the possibilities just are endless. Mm. And that's something our generation is probably, not even our parents' generation, our generation probably is the first generation who's trying to figure things out, that, you know, you don't need to be known as one person. You could have multiple personalities. You could have, like, there are so many vloggers I know who have full-time jobs, yet they're, you know, travel vloggers. How do they do that? Like, in this age, you have the tools available with you. You have the data, the fundamental learnings that you can, like, you know, just have access to anytime you want. And that's just mad. Like, tomorrow could learn 3D or learn to be, put yourself in positions where you never thought you could be. And it's just mad how awesome that is. Like, our generation in particular has...
Yeah, I think we're very well positioned to keep experimenting, and all you need is the will to do it and the curiosity to drive that, right?
While you were speaking, something that stood out to me was you were talking about how, you know, people in other professions often glamorize, you know, travel photography. But I'm sure, like, while you're in it, there are some perils. In fact, I have seen you on the job when we were taking a trip to Bolivia together. And I was sitting there getting bored out of my wits while you were doing, like, this long-ass time lapse. And I was just thinking, gosh, it takes so much patience to be a photographer, right? And I'm sure that, like, there's so many hardships that you must have faced on your in your experiences. Could you share some anecdotes, and what would your advice be for some upcoming photographers around, you know, persevering through them? Yeah.
So, thanks for noticing that. I am
She told me about it. She's like, man, Arjun puts in too much effort for one picture.
I was dying. I was like, rubbish. Oh my God, this is boring as hell.
Rubbish. So what I would say to that is, I think any profession, if you really want to excel, you need to give in that time and have patience. We live in a world of instant gratification, and that's not easy. But it's to create something unique, you need to put in that effort, because that's why it's unique, right? Like, so my initial project that I started off with, like back in the day, was India Changes the Perception. And
yep, that this video, which is thousands
that.
And thousands
that's super viral.
Yeah.
We
yeah,
will
so,
put it in our show links. Yes.
Right. So I was a kid back then, and I was still like just got my first DSLR, and I was trying to figure how can I make a portfolio in photography and create something that has not been seen much as of now. So I started thinking. As a travel photographer, it totally made sense for me to indulge in a project that shows India in a new way. And that new way was time lapse. It's not like I did anything very remarkable, but what I tried to do was spend a lot of time and my resources, whatever I had, into going to these places that were not as well known back in the day.
Hmm.
Like Andaman Islands, like there were like two flights to Andaman Islands when I was there, and they were crazy expensive flights because nobody really goes there except foreigners. And then Northeast India and all of these like small spots in Himachal. And so I kind of took that as a project, and I traveled for like 3-4 months continuously. Or like I used to come down to my home for like 2-3 days and go back again. And I exhausted all my funds that way. But I was confident that I could create something that, you know, stands out. So then I made a time-lapse video, and it kind of did the rounds. It got published on it got published on like BuzzFeed and like all of these, like NDTV.
If you're on BuzzFeed, and you're famous, dude. Legit famous.
NDTV, then you're
so all of that is unexpected, and but it actually shows you that, you know, you don't really need all you need to do is start, right? And once I did that, I was confident enough that, you know, my goal wasn't to become famous or anything, or become to reach this to millions of people, but my goal was just to like create something new. And as long as your intention is pure, and it doesn't have the fluff around it that so many people need to see it, or I need to impress such and such. I think as long as it comes from a pure place that this is what I want to do and this is what I want to like create, I think it will work. When I say it will work, it doesn't mean that it has to reach a million people. That maybe that's not your goal, and that's not what should restrict and calling yourself a failure if that doesn't happen. But it's all about, I think for me, it's all about creating. I love the process of creating something that never existed, and getting in and just putting it out there and seeing how people react. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Like I have worked on plenty of projects after that. Probably I've worked harder on those projects which never saw the light of day. And I'm not disappointed by it, because I feel like different projects speak to different people, and your effort should not be, you should not be putting yourself down just because it didn't do the rounds on social media. I mean, social media is like a funny thing. And as long as you can put something on your portfolio, and that's all that matters. So when it comes to my recent most project, which is a collaboration with the Indian Army, I've been like, I'm just a freelance photographer at the time, right? And I'm trying to reach out to the Indian Army. And you know how the Indian Army is, right? Like thousands of emails.
Hierarchy, bureaucracy. Yeah.
So I'll just give you a short story of what all happened for me to make this project happen, right? So I had this initial idea of, you know, I wanted to like show the Indian Army in a very contemporary way, because whatever exists of the Indian Army online was, it even if you Google it today, right now, it feels like you're still in the 70s and
for
80s,
sure. Yeah.
Where you have these old, outdated technology and people, and the work culture is, it does not reflect the contemporary approach to what the Indian Army is today, right? So even my dad used to kind of have this as a running thought.
Hmm.
So I decided that I need to reach out to the Indian Army, and I want to put my skills to the right place, because it was like a pro bono shoot, and I wanted to pitch out to them. I don't want to charge them anything, but I just wanted to make sure that, you know, if they can use my service and you know, probably help them reach out to a broader audience. Because few things that were happening were 2017, they had the lowest commissions.
Absolutely.
For the Indian Army. So I tried to identify these problems, and I tried to make a pitch wherein you kind of rebrand the perception of the Indian Army. I reached out to them, I like through email and phone calls, but it's ADGPI, which is the office based out of Delhi, right?
Mm-hmm.
No response, and I kept trying. I tried all my contacts through
yeah.
my mom, through my uncles, through everybody I knew, and like somebody get in touch with me to the right people. And then 3 months down the line, I was sleeping on the bed, and I suddenly got a call. It's a private number. I can't see the number. It says zero.
Oh.
And I pick it up. And,
hi, Funda.
I know, right? So I pick up the call, and I'm initially asked, so you're Arjun Menon, blah, blah, blah. We saw your proposal. We would like to meet you tomorrow. And I was like, okay, I'm not based out of Delhi.
Mm-hmm.
I'm based out of somewhere in Bombay. Can day after tomorrow work? They were like, let me check. He kept me on hold, and he was like, yeah, day after tomorrow, 10:30, see you. And he kept the phone.
Crazy.
And then I got a text from an officer that this is the address you need to come down to. I quickly booked the flights, and I had a morning flight, and I ended up with all my luggage going directly for this interview. So I had this bag, and I had put this address on Uber, and Uber kept going. And we reached the Rashtrapati Bhavan. I was like,
oh my god, are you being
what?
I didn't see that coming.
And then the Uber guy is like, sir, aap ho kaun? Aap kya kar rahe ho? Aap kya kar rahe ho? And then I reached the security, and I was just testing my luck. And I was like, I'm Arjun Menon, I have an appointment and so and so. And they were like, go. And I was like, oh shit.
Gosh.
And then so I entered the Rashtrapati Bhavan whole area, and they had like few security checks, and I was carrying my luggage, such a no-no, because not even mobile phones are allowed inside. So
oh.
I was requesting the security guy, dude. He was an army bhaiya, so I was like,
yeah.
please
jigar bhaiya, main bhi army ka bachcha hu.
Main bhi army ka bachcha hu, aap thoda side mein rakh sakte ho, aap chahe to screen kar lo, jo karna hai dekh lo, kuch nahi hai usme. So I got through, I went in for the meeting. This gentleman was really like to the point. We probably had a meeting for like 20 minutes.
Mm.
he asked me, what do you want? And I was like, I'm such and such. I had a printed portfolio because nothing else is allowed inside. I showed him my pictures and I was like, I've worked with some of the best brands and I want to just put my skills to use for the Indian Army. And it's like a long shot because not everyone understands rebranding and branding and a free pro bono service. They might just be thinking on the other way that, you know, this guy could be, you know, why does he want to do it for free? Yeah. Why does he want to do it for me? I'm sure he has some alternate these things to it.
Yeah, especially traditional institutes like the government or the Indian Army.
Exactly,
right? They're very risk averse. Yep.
Exactly. So, like, for them, there's not much to gain out of this situation, but a lot to lose, right? Because what I was potentially asking them was to grant me access to secure, like, military bases all around their borders and have, like, have access and, like, have control over a few photographs that I want to take, which is kind of weird as a request. But they were very open to it. And, like, his initial question was, okay, you don't want to charge something? That's fine. That's great. And I gave him the whole history that my dad was in the army and this is what I want to do it. And then he just said, you know, we'll get back to you. Came back to Bombay. 1 month gone, nothing. 2 months gone, nothing.
Typical.
3 months gone, nothing. Suddenly I get another call.
Your file is lost somewhere.
Yeah. I mean, so the first officer I spoke to, he was like, this file has been going around and there are like millions of approvals that need to come down from the top guys to the bottommost.
Defense minister, everyone.
Exactly. Everyone needs to be involved in this because they can't have a glitch. And then they were like, these are some of the dates that work and these are the 3-4 bases that we are aiming for, which had, so I initially had requested them for like a desert background, snow background and a regular forest background. These are particular areas that the Indian Army operates in. The dates were fixed. I show up for my first shoot, right? And so nothing has been discussed that what we are going to do, but as my so they got me a pickup from the airport and as I was reaching in, I was looking out of the window and I saw like paratroopers falling from the sky.
My God!
And I was like, "Bhaiya, gaadi roko, I need to go and shoot." So I kept my bag inside, everything. I just rushed out of the car. This thing, I had one lens on me. I have not been introduced to the officers here. I'm like risking it all because to them, I'm just like some long haired guy.
Random dude.
Randomly coming and trying to photograph this. I shoot like them coming in and it was like beautiful. And then I kind of go and introduce myself and they were super excited to have me on board and they gave me like the most, made sure that I had 100% freedom to do what I wanted to do because they trusted me with the process, which is very difficult with traditional traditional school of thought, right? But they were like completely pushing for me. So I then like, you know, photographed whatever I needed and I thought, you know, what fits best for the Indian Army over the next 2 months. So all in all, it took me 1 year to just start shooting. And then it took me like 2 months to complete that project. And they had a process of approvals, right? Because whatever I'm photographing is not accessible to regular civilians. So they wanted to approve all that. That process itself took like 3 months because, again, it has to go through all of them.
Everyone wants to look at all the pictures, yeah.
All the pictures and make sure no data has been leaked. So I made sure even the helicopter names and batches for officers, everything was removed and there's no particular identity I was throwing out there. Even the bases, I wasn't allowed to reveal what bases I was shooting at.
Of course.
So I totally respect that and I see why that is. I had 1 year of waiting on these images because they initially said that we'll publish these images but through the calendar. So I had to wait for the calendar year to get over. I was in Feb and then they said, let's publish it the next year. I was like, oh my God, like how much
some
time...
colonel somewhere must be like, aisa idea karte hai, let's do this.
Yeah, and I am in no place to argue with them.
Of course.
Okay. I mean, that's your choice. So then they had a...
So how long did it take to see the
start to finish,
light of day?
Yeah.
Yeah, start to finish.
It took me almost 2 years.
Wow.
Basically, because 1 year to start shooting. As I said, each meeting, I had like 3 meetings. Each meeting was after like 3 months and stuff. Approvals and convincing. And first shoot to the last shoot was around 2 months because we had like different brackets of availability in different places. And then that 8 or 9 months of sitting on the images. And then finally, I got to publish the images in the start of last year, and I had a crazy response because probably because this is the first time you're seeing the Indian Army in a very different perspective and very contemporary way, and I had access to some of the best tech, and so I'm not like probably 30 or 40% of my photographs were kind of censored because they revealed some of the other kind of data. Yeah, because they had like drones and stuff and you know, unmanned all
so
of that
cool
happening.
Though.
Yeah.
Bro, that's so fascinating. Like,
it was...
So I remember when this came out, like this edition of your project came out, like the Indian Army, right? And it came, I think, on either Republic Day or Independence Day. Which one was it?
I started off on 1st of Jan and I had planned it in a way that it heads through.
Yeah, I was so proud of you, Arjun, especially as an army brat. Like, just I was going gaga and I was like, all my social media, and I'm not even active on social media, but Facebook post after 2 years, I like post was just all your pictures and they're gorgeous. For those of you who haven't seen it,
we'll obviously link it in the show notes.
You will feel like a proud Indian when you... look
yeah,
at pictures,
I mean,
so.
So again, all that people see is the final product. The kind of work that goes into it is a different game of its own, and those are things that you probably don't learn in schools. And those are like actual experience, talking to people, convincing them, convincing people who are like 30 years older than you that you know, you are the right person to do something. Or there are hundreds of other factors, but patience. So my whole point was, you need to be patient, because without patience, with only this world of instant gratification, I mean, I'm sure you can become famous and stuff, but my whole challenge is, to myself, and do I impress myself with my work, is the question I keep asking myself. I don't like to be compared to other photographers, or I have reached a point where I don't see the point in doing that, because everybody has their own journey. As long as you are trying to copy someone's work, or I mean take inspiration from someone's work, you are not actually tapping into yourself. So so then the whole challenge is between you and your whole motive is to impress yourself. So where does that take you is it's a thing to explore by yourself.
That's beautiful. So nice to see you become also mature.
Yeah, from like the little kids that we knew.
So grown up.
Actually, what you said, what you said right there is applicable to anything in life, right?
Anything
Any field
and all, fields,
and all
yeah.
people. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yep, absolutely. Just not comparing and really just looking at yourself and yeah, and self-actualizing, right?
That's true. Like, I kept comparing myself to Aarti all my life. I was like, oh, shit.
And you
now she's,
the kind of stuff
now
that
she's
does.
Traveling in South America. Oh, man. Now she's working in South America. Oh, Howard. Oh, my God. Like,
Arre,
come
yeah,
on.
Shut
stop
up,
it.
Please.
Stop it, Aarti.
Guys, boring our listeners will be like, these guys are just doing mutual admiration club. Move on.
Mutual admiration.
But you guys did go to, you travel to Antarctica together too. Like, I can't believe you guys have done so many fun things.
Yeah. So my whole Antarctica thing happened because solely because of Aarti. One day I wake up there's a post on Facebook like, oh, I'm going to Antarctica and she has a crowdfunder. I'm like,
Arjun's like, I want to do this too. How are you doing?
I was like, how and what? And I was like, oh shit, I need to get in touch with her. So I called her up. I think I called her up after like what 14 years or something, and we've just been chatting over these years. But I was like, dude, I need to get up. I need to understand what's happening and how. And I called her up, and she was the most sweetest person. She
Hello.
Told me the entire process.
I really want to interrupt you right now and not hear
True
nice chatty things
buddies.
About
okay,
myself
go on.
And
next.
And then put the spotlight back on you because we are interviewing you. Yes.
So
all that you shared. Your entire story was just, you know, the biggest takeaways for me around, just for the field of photography, just patience, which is like, I completely see that in you, but also people skills. And I can vouch for that. I've seen you in action and you're just so lovable, Arjun. Everyone just loves having you around.
And clicking
so,
pictures.
Yeah.
The most important
thing
is
to
do
pictures,
it.
Pictures, of course. Yeah. The most important thing. But like beyond just, you know, your technical skills, like these skills really matter. I see that.
Yeah.
And clearly, through your army project, also you showed us, you gave us an insight into the hardships on the back end. Just wanted to know from you, what are the lengths to which you have gone to take a photograph? What's the craziest thing you've done?
One of the stories for my South America trip was I was somewhere in Peru, and there's this whole jungle with leopards, and it's like a part of the Amazon, right? So there's this hike that goes and reaches a viewpoint, and there's an amazing view there. So I got there early, and I noticed that there was absolutely nobody. I never crossed anybody's path when I was reaching there, and I reached the viewpoint, and I had an amazing view, perfect day, like everything happening. I started shooting my time lapse, and usually, you know, time lapses take a long time. The hike was 2.5 hours. I see this amazing sunset happening. I'm like, dude, I need to get the sunset, right? So I'm waiting. I see the sun going down, and I see the clouds.
I see where this is going.
I don't let him continue.
Beautiful. I was like, what a beautiful sunset. And then I switch off the camera and suddenly realize, oh shit, it's dark. I don't have a torch with me because I came at mid-afternoon.
God.
And I have to do a 2.5 hour trek through the jungle to get to the main road. I was like, suddenly I started panicking. I was like, oh shit.
And you have leopards for company. Fab.
Exactly. And this is a part of the Amazon, so leopards are just one animal. But there are like alligators, there are like a whole ton of spiders and snakes that I don't even this is why you should educate yourself when you're going for a trek and be well prepared, right? I didn't do that. I started running like never before. I started running through the path. The forest was so dense that I could only see the sky once in a while, and I would come to know, okay, it's that dark now. So otherwise there's absolutely no light there. I was running, and I go through these bushes and suddenly I feel like I'm lost because the way ended. And I started panicking because I could hear animals all around me because footsteps and tree bugs and monkeys and I started panicking. You know what? Like, this is not even the US or some like great developed country where people will actually come looking for you, because nobody knows that I even went there and nobody crossed my path, and all these things are going through my head, and I'm lost. So I'm trying to go back to the way that I came in, and still I can't find it. I was like, screw it. I see this half pathway. I'm sure that that's not the pathway I came through. But I was like, this is the only way out right now. I go through it. It's not even a proper pathway. So I'm going through bushes and...
Arjun.
It's completely dark. You can't see anything. I don't have a torch. And I'm just hoping that this path leads me to the like the right actual pathway. And then suddenly I come across this bush and I end up in the actual pathway. I was like, thank God. Because all this while I'm thinking, this could end up anywhere. This could end up maybe, because they had so many curves and turns. I was like, this could end up in some other viewing point. God knows, because I didn't have any maps on me.
Or no cell network, of course, right? Nothing.
Obviously. Yeah. Nothing. Like, no Google, no nothing.
No way.
If I die there, I die there.
Gosh.
So then somehow I ran through that path again and again and again, and I could feel like animals all around me. But I ended up at the road and was like, oh shit, I'm never doing this again.
Yeah, that's crazy lens, man. We all have to see that time lapse of that sunset. I'm sure it's like, you know, the lens that you went to
it was mad. Because the things like these keep happening, and probably the end product is not even that great, but you end up having so many bloody stories around you. Even Arki, if you remember the I think it's Lake
Titicaca.
Not Lake Titicaca. So what was the one in Ecuador, the crater one?
Oh, Quilotoa.
Quilotoa, yeah.
Quilotoa.
So when I was camping there, the guys who were just wrapping up their camp the previous day, they told me there are dogs here. And I was like, I love dogs. I was like, and what happened was, I was again shooting a time lapse in the night. And then like zero light around. I don't know if you've seen it in the night, but zero light around. There's a village close by, but it's on the other side of the hill, so you can't be seen from anywhere. I could hear dogs barking from far away, and I'm sure they are barking at me, because whenever I would move or something, they start barking. And then as I was photographing, I could hear a rustle, like, gosh, as if something is rushing, like cantering towards you. And I had no idea what it is. I could only hear like bushes happening. I'm coming towards me, and it turned out like 2-3 dogs, and they were very aggressive dogs.
Sure, they're not like Labradors or Golden Retrievers or cuddly ones. These are hyenas.
I was waiting to have some company with dogs. And I was like, I need dogs.
Of course, I love dogs.
Yeah, exactly. But these guys were so aggressive. What I had to do was, so then I had recollected a story that one of the campers got bitten by a dog. So their whole pant was torn off, and they had to rush to the medic, which was close by, to get some shots. So all this is going through my head, and then I pick up my tripod, and my tripod is the only kind of weapon that I had, and I started like shooing them away, and like another 3-4 dogs. And I'm on an edge because I'm photographing the
lake,
the lake, and it's like a cliff. Shit.
It's the dog or the deep sea. Deep lake.
Somehow, somehow, like, I managed to shoo them away. I could feel that they were there throughout the night, but I gave up and I was sleeping inside my tent and I was just hoping for sunrise. And yeah, there are like plenty of stories like this.
Man, I know we can go on and on. I'm sure we'll like keep chatting all night if this happens. But oh god, this has been so much fun, Arjun. Thanks for sharing such nitty gritty, you know, fabulous, fascinating incidents, and just I think they really take us back to those times and what really goes into being a creative, right? How you tell that story and be that creative. So because you're on the Life of a Global Desi podcast, what does the term Global Desi mean to you? Do you think of yourself as a Global Desi? Why or why not?
Global Desi is the initial idea of Global Desi is somebody who represents, and somebody that you like instantly connect with as a person, somebody that has like you feel somebody cool doing cool things and somebody aspirational. Maybe I don't know why I'm here, but
because of all those things.
But that's the initial thought that comes into when you say Global Desi. But yeah, crazy.
Cool.
Awesome.
This is super fab. Is there anything else that you would like our listeners to know about you? I think they've really gotten to understand your motivations. At least I and Aarti, even more if that's possible, right? Than we already know.
Let me just continue with my army project and
yes,
what I learned from it. I started that project, as I said, like I went through all of these layers of difficulties of dealing with different things. One thing that happened in the middle was, look, so on a daily basis, I'm photographing like 5 helicopters and the kind of, it is almost like a scale of a Hollywood film.
Wow.
Because in Bollywood also, you don't see 3-4 helicopters at a time. And it was just mad because I was directing them. And so my whole aspect to it was very technical and very very contemporary. But one of the discussions I was having with, so I was at an army mess, we were having lunch and
dal chawal, I love it.
Exactly, dal chawal, oh my
yeah,
god.
Army mess dal chawal is the best, man.
Best, especially areas like Leh,
yes,
or these remote places, mad stuff. So I was having my dal chawal and we were just discussing, we were just making fun of each other because all of the officers are also kind of my
very
age,
young,
the young officers. And they were like, why are you, you know, wasting your time and spending so much money and doing all this shit, you know, like tomorrow they might say that you can't release the pictures also. What will you do then? And my initial thought was, till now my whole perspective was that this adds to my portfolio, right? Having something like this adds to my portfolio and that's why I'm doing it. And then suddenly another officer, I'm still in deep thought that actually, like, after all of this, after spending so much money, and I did spend a considerable amount of money because I had like a lot of travel and a lot of equipment that I was carrying. And I was like, after all of this, if this doesn't even get published tomorrow, some uncle somewhere says that, you know, these pictures, they're great, but
yeah,
you can't use them publicly. What do I do? I don't have any backup plans, right? I'm in this train of thought, and then suddenly one more officer interrupts him, and he's like, he's not doing this project for the Indian Army or to impress himself or anything. This is a tribute to his dad. And for me, I suddenly froze and I was like, shit, that's the whole idea behind this project. And I didn't even know about it because for somebody outside, it's very apparent. But for me to figure out this whole thing that, you know, why am I putting so much effort into it is not because I want to make the people in the army happy, but have some kind of a closure with my dad. And so this came through like full circle when I told you like I had not been talking to him and for a while before it happened, and I went through this whole phase of like blaming myself for everything because I was fighting with him somehow. And this was probably my way of getting in terms to those things and, you know, closure. And that's the first time I kind of, I teared up that time. And I was like, this all makes sense now. Like, the kind of shit I'm going through, it all makes sense that this is why I'm doing it. It's beyond, I can't even, like, it's probably that officer said it best. And, you know, I can't even, like, try to explain it in my words. But it suddenly, like, everything just aligned. Like, I was like, this is why I'm doing it. And so then my perspective towards the project also changed. I got in a lot of human elements to the project. I reframed my train of thought, and I was like, dude, I don't want to have these technical images. I want to have something that speaks emotions and has people and tells a story. Like, it's all about the people, right?
Yep, absolutely.
It's people like your dad and my dad who were in the army, and that's what I want to show more of. And thankfully, this came midway through the project, and I kind of altered my approach, and I saw that difference in my images afterwards. So then it became like a proper set of images which had like decent technical skills and emotions and real people and real emotions. And, yeah, so you never know what you're chasing. And it's probably, it's a good thing to ask for criticism, because it's very apparent to other people to figure you out and your story. But for you to do it yourself, like the amount of time you have to put into it, it's just unbelievable that, So it suddenly all came through, and this whole project made more sense to me, and it now has a more respectable place in my portfolio for it.
Absolutely. In fact, it's so interesting that a third person has such an objective view of who you are, and it's more apparent to them than ourselves sometimes. And I remember when I first saw those pictures, Arjun, you won't believe it. The first thought that came to me was, oh, this is what Arjun's doing. Like, it's for his dad. You know, it's men and uncle would be so proud to see these pictures. And I was like, it was so clear to me, you know, obviously, on top of just how beautiful the pictures were. So thanks for sharing that. I think it's so, I mean, it's great that you were vulnerable enough to share that with everyone, right? Aarti, me, and the listeners. It really gives them an insight into why you do what you do, right? That's the whole point of this.
So that's so these are the kind of, like, this is just self-reflection. Then you come to a point wherein you, like, then it does not make sense for you to chase somebody else. All it takes is to look at your history, your background, and understand the kind of person you are. Because although it's cliched that believe in yourself and all of that, but ultimately the more you start unraveling yourself, the more unique you become. So and your strengths lie in that. So I feel like that way I also discovered a lot of things about myself through these projects. Yeah.
Arjun, I think that's a great way to leave this episode at. And hopefully that's a fantastic learning and message for everyone. And just, you know, a reflection point. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for sharing that. And so mad fun having you on, man. Like, this is like a great a great way to do this. And we always keep, Aarti and I keep saying, you know, why we do this podcast is to even just get to know our friends better and, you know, just get to know their motivations.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I haven't heard half of these stories.
Yeah,
like,
me neither.
Half of these stories.
I'm totally grateful that you guys even started this and had me in your mind, God knows why. But proper respect to what you guys are doing, and I'm really proud of you guys. All the very
thank
best.
You
thank you so
thank
much
you.
Oh wait, before we let you go, Where can people find you on social media?
Just Google him. He's very pop famous.
Yeah, he is actually. He's like one of those people you write.
There are lots of Arjun photographers. So,
how can they connect with you? Where can they find you on social media? Yeah.
It's a very. My company name is a very. I'm not proud of it. I came up with it long back. It's called Art Leaves a Mark.
Yep. So why are you not proud of it? It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. We love it.
Well, I was a kid back then, and now I feel like it's too, it's a bit cringy. Yeah.
Oh, no.
But yeah, so that's my handle on Instagram. And I'm not that active on Facebook, but Instagram is primarily where I'm at. So please reach out to me. I feel honored to take questions and
fantastic. All the budding photographers, take note, and even just people, you know, who want to learn more about Arjun, please connect with them on Instagram at Art Leaves a Mark, and we'll have the link on our show notes. Great. Yay, thank awesome. You. Thank you, everyone. And thanks, Arjun. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. And to our listeners, stay curious and
peace out.
And keep listening.
Keep listening.
All right. See you.
Take care, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.
Hey Desis, if you enjoyed this episode, then please rate, review, and subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever else you're listening to podcasts.
And drop us a note on lifeofaglobaldesi@gmail.com or our social media to keep up this awesome dialogue.
Oh, and don't forget to give us a 5-star rating.
You're so cheap. Why are you asking them for 5-star ratings?
Well, I always ask for the rating I want, not the one I have. You know, like dress for the job you want, not the one you have.
That's like the stupidest thing I've heard all day.
Arti, you're so judgmental. What? You need to stop being judgmental.
I just think you can't be so demanding. That's all.
You ask for what you want.
Bleh.